so anything I tell you will just be duplicative. So I'm just going to say, go, Susan, and I'll be in the back getting chairs for folks who might show up.
Okay,
thanks. Thank
you so much, Carol. Well, this is an extraordinary moment. It's great to see you all here. Most of you know I've been working my imagination off to do this book that I'm very excited about because I'm in love with pastels. So I thought what I would do is talk a little bit about what pastels are. There should be a little slideshow here moving around of some of the pages in the book. And then I'll talk about what I think about poetry and then start reading. If you have any questions or when I'm done with the poem, what did you mean by that metaphor? I really have no idea. Well, we could go down a moderate rabbit hole to explore what that is. So my poetry gets really abstract or metaphoric. As I was looking back at it, I actually found there's in particular a couple poems, one called The Open Envelope and the other called April's Something. And it turns out, I put them on facing pages, and The Open Envelope is really a good poem for courage, having a voice, and the one next to it, April's whatever it is a really good poem for relief, ease, and grace. So again, this is the cover. I did it this way. It's 11 by 11, and the pages are really thick, and the print is larger, so people over 38 can actually see it without glasses, perhaps. So, here we go. I will first read a word about pastels, and with it, on the top, there's a painting, a pastel that I call Call of a Mystic. Mm-hmm. A word about pastels. The pastel medium dates back to Degas and Monet. Pastels are made from pure pigments. Some people refer to them as chalk, but they're not chalk once you're past elementary school in terms of fine art. Pastels are made from pure pigments, the same pigments as oil paints, formulated with different binder. Pastels come in stick form in a variety of relative shapes, textures, and sizes. I brought some examples for you to see. Various techniques from learned to intuitive create the imagery. Mark making brings individual energy and carries the signature, so to speak, of the artist. One can paint loosely, more methodically, or both. Pastel trays often are arranged by hue, chroma, saturation, and intensity, and value affects color. Any questions? No. So value, I love what value is. Value is if you squint and go from dark to light, pull out the color from the world that you see, you can start to see in a value scale. So these, for instance, these purple Rembrandt brand pastels, I arranged by value. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different values from dark to light. Want to make it straight. There.
Do you want me to pass it around so they can...
No, that's okay. Thank you. Okay. We don't want them to drop.
Yeah.
They're so easy to drop.
I don't want to breathe on either.
Everything, you know.
Yeah.
Everything you can think of.
Okay. Sorry.
Yeah. I'm going to skip the page about the artist because I'm here and you're here. Now I'm going to read something I wrote. It's called Thoughts About Poetry. Find the handle to a poem. I wrote this because some people just don't relate it all to poetry, I find. Some people have said, I really like or love your artwork, but but poetry not so much. So I felt it important to say something about how to try to enter into a poem. Where does one find the handle to a poem? Along a simple path or deep within an old-growth forest? Perhaps in an attic full of memories, viewing a Renaissance sculpture, stargazing, or listening to the chorus of a barnyard full of hens. Roses are red, violets are blue, Shakespeare, Stafford, Mary Oliver, Billy Collins, Al Young, Michael McClure, Ferlinghetti, Dylan Thomas, Maya Angelou, Mina Loy. Mina Loy is great. She's very abstract, by the way. Joni Mitchell, Leonard Cohen, Rumi, Hafiz, Wordsworth, Longfellow, Gibran, Dylan, and Baez. Poets are romantics, rebels, and philosophers. Perhaps what all poets have in common is the need to express and communicate, to rally for justice, search for the spiritual, praise beauty or nature, find meaning within the profound or mundane, to somehow make sense of the world. Whether reverie or reality, poetry can take many forms beyond the table talk of quote-unquote pass the salt. A poem can refer to history, commemorate a significant moment in time, reveal a shadow, or shine a light. Poetry is a language of moments remembered, new vistas and interpretations. Thoughts lead to poems, and poems lead to thoughts. Some poems provide a clear compass with specific calculations, progressions, and conclusions. Other poems might allude to a path, giving space for the viewer to find their own way. You know how sometimes we like being told what to do, and sometimes we do not want to be told what to do? Some poems feel like jazz or a dream time occurrence. Some build, and before you know it, you are standing in a doorway of realization. My poems tend to be more abstract and stream of consciousness, with roots in the process and the sensory. I am guided by impressions from both intuitive and visual worlds. Alice's White Rabbit, metaphor and whimsy, lost sometimes, or found with empathies and affinities, observations. These are some of my guideposts and meanderings, nature, art, beauty, contemplations, and creativity. Then I said, so dear reader, if you have come this far, thank you for being here. Pull up a chair and pour a cup of tea. Interpret as you will. Enjoy the journey. So that's this page. And then I'll read the wee hour. The wee hours. Once again, the wee hours brush across the moon, extend across the universe, brush the highest mountains and trail and twig and tall fir branches, caress silken backs of birds, fill warm crackled smokestacks of cobble with care, and then with neither turn or tilt, they trickle and sweep along ceramic kitchen tiles, across bookshelves, around and down, spelling out days in every language. If you could choose just one letter, what would it be? Could you see that okay? This is a very colorful poem, and how could it not be? It's about pastels. And this is about water. You never want to get water on a pastel painting unless you mean it. Very grateful for the water. This is called Ode to Pastels. Another rolling, layered poem. I overheard them thinking, the precursor of someone talking, about a pastel crayon. I know of no such thing, I mean to say, or intuit, To me, a blade of grass is cool. Blue-green on the slanted, shady side, high in chroma, saturation, intensity, on the warm, sunny side, on fringes and parchments of purity, where the color wheel defines the universe. And a crayon within grammar school reaches elementary applications on wings of intuition, innocence, and joy. Sometimes I put colors down quickly, or I could move slowly so you could follow me, or I could follow you. I'm talking to the viewer now, and I'm sure there's a rule about that. When does the reader become the judge? Or the listener, patient and assessing? How long to maintain pattern or change course? To what means is homeostasis the ultimate navigator? How deep or how high do we look? These pastels, they sit in trays and boxes, sticks of pure pigment, handmade, turned by the touch, identified by hue, or once placed on paper, noting simultaneous contrast, hoping for secure positions, knowing palette shifts approach each moment as predictably as tide shifts within the ocean. There is no fixed thing as simplicity on the earth plane. In this instance, light or the Munsell color wheel is the best diagnostic. Hue, chroma, value, saturation, intensity, soil colors are even given numbers. When the earth is wet, affected by weather and rain, scale and chart that. Find the numbers and oxides. When history is wet or dry, and by how many degrees? And why the eternal question? Aho and amen, the eternal answer. Where when is now? Always is sometimes a shade of gray, or a rose-orange sky infused with indigo, where heaven on earth is the goal. I love everybody right now. I'm really glad you came. It's so great to share this, you know that? I want to show you a little something about the pastels and why a person could actually fall in love with them and choose them as their single partner. So this is a harder pastel. The brand is Rembrandt. And we are told to take off the label, break the pastel stick, because then you can have more movement with it. Okay, here, see the very corner. And then you can use the side and maybe leave a little space. And then make your hand even do things like this. Mm-hmm. And there's so much joy in what can happen. Mm-hmm. And then just noting in terms of, you know, nomenclature or glossary or something, the positive and negative shapes of things. And that has a lot to do with how the composition shakes out. Mm-hmm. So that's just a little information. And now for fun, I'm going to go to the lightest value on this string of Rembrandt pastels. Oh, hello. So this is light. So I'm going to decide that there's a light source and put it up here. And you know what I love about all this? With any creativity, there's so much thinking and inquiry, and then you get to look back at it like, hey, there are results here that I can see, and creativity is such a gift for all of us, right? It puts us in some kind of emergence and integration in our own lives. So this is part of the joy of pastels. This is sanded paper, the brand is UART, and the grade is 500. This is very dense in terms of descriptive words. I wasn't going to read it right away, but I will. Prismatic ecosystems. to shimmering gold, yellow, orange, shades of sienna, burnt umber, the cool of cyan, blue, greens, pastels, spectrums infused in Mother Nature. Earthy soil supports us, moss, lichen, and fern, forest ground in madronas, ancient tree roots, where deer hooves step, branches reach up to the sky. We are blessed to walk here, where bird songs fill morning and night, tidal streams reveal waves, ebb currents, cerulean, turquoise, in mass and moments, informing us line by line. Sea spray enlivens, creek beds replace longing, present with calm reflection, and the colors, one iridescent peacock shimmers by, blackberry brambles, blushing anthocyanins, seven shiny crows raise a raspy chorus, one black and white eagle perches overhead, while pileated woodpeckers tap, 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 sheep flock in grassy fields, munching chlorophyll, butterflies flutter, monarchs to milkweed, flora and fauna and the colors, oh the colors, ode to joy. Mm-hmm. Any questions? Any thoughts? Anything compulsive to say?
We love you too.
I love you too.
I love the anthocyanins, if you will.
Yes. It's fun to get a word and you want the right word and you know you have to ground it somewhere, and so you go to Google. Go to directly to Pastel. And on that note of speed, this is called If I Had Gone More Slowly. Can everyone see? Lots of good blue. There's so many gorgeous blues. For instance, this is this gorgeous blue. Let's see, these are darker values, so I'm gonna put this here because I feel like it. Sometimes it's a decision of the mind, and sometimes it's because I feel like it. Now I just want water there. I'm not gonna do anything except for I changed my mind right there. And then it's very good to be careful not to put the central focus in the middle of the paper. So in terms of composition, it's like, don't split the viewer down the middle. And then this is a lighter shade, and I'm just gonna put it here because that's what it wants to do. Just, you know, it's just so great to be able to move your hand, you know? Mm-hmm. And as we get older, to see that we can move our hands, that's fantastic. There. Yeah. Back to the water. If I had gone more slowly, if I had gone more slowly, I could, or I would, have felt more deeply the tenderness of breezes arising, furled rustling, sashaying reeds, the swaying of trees. I would listen more closely to the knowing songs of Mother Nature as evening makes headway without dictate or thought of proposal. Sunlight slowly greets the golden moon in language only the sky can understand. If I had gone more slowly, there would be no need for the multiple towers of Babel, no need to voice ironies, no need to name polarities, no need to concur that human nature is somehow superior to anything or anyone at any time. When love for all is spoken, understood, and silence moves, maintaining a snail's pace, speed loses all power. Stillness becomes the teacher. Grace prevails, and we know ourselves, eternal stardust, after all.
It's a powerful message.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Beautiful.
You You can all hear me?
Yes.
Okay, here's a Googleable word. You know when you go, hey, I like this word, what does it mean? So I looked up a priori. This is called quest a priori hemispheres. And a priori pretty much means knowledge based on theory, not experience. Correct me or add to it if you like.
What kind of experience?
Data rather than experiential. This is a long, very dense poem. Quest a priori hemispheres. This is kind of a plea, isn't it? I asked writing to guide me through myriad images, buds and blossoms, broken stems, refracted light, tablecloths, woven baskets, paint tubes, bookends. Spell out curved bellied vowels, curt consonants, please. Can't you do that for me, for us? Our hearts haven't failed you. They never really could. Crimson buds and white pear flowers, cowbells ringing in flash-tongued fields, evening moon crests, turning phase and tides, wide-eyed horned owl hoots all night, mirroring metronome moments. There must be a miracle we can cup in our hands, forgiving everything that has no name, for the deeper things, the nuances lacking in language. This is the next page. I'm just showing you the image. I asked writing to guide me, offer riddle-free. I noticed I didn't even need my glasses. Wait a minute. That's a good text size. Okay. Woohoo! God, I can't see now. Wait. I asked writing to guide me. Offer riddle-free vowels, clear consonants, please, across horizon lines of cerebellum, cerebral cortex, infrastructures predetermined, a priori hemispheres. There must be a place where radar meets the nexus of everything, detecting blue or cloudy skies, amplitudes and equilibriums of vibrating waves. Fountain pens and paper clips, ringing phones and doorbells. Remember doorbells? I shake my head. Long ago, ice cream trucks, spearmint leaves, strawberry plants, honeysuckle vines, rich terra firma, earth we could count on, things that never seemed to move. Now, monkeys flee quickly, limb to limb, truncated by quickening breezes. Storms startle fickle eyes, curtailing aerial perspectives, shades of gray. Once again, O sermons of Babel, why can't you escape this circus of time? Perhaps we can see beyond brackets and fractions, judgments and fear. We just need to remember. What is it we value? The people? The monkeys? Will we know by our actions? Will we judge by one mistake? Will we give them, quote unquote, a quota, as we label fixed and random patterns perceived in changing light? I love this lady's face. There's one more page to the poem. What if we forget to forgive? What if we qualify evolution? Forget their humanness, the many momentary fallings from grace. Can we trust beyond the stumbles? I wanted the letters to explain the pictures, the imagery I seemed to bow to. Tree bark and leaf ellipse, sky holes, specular and diffused reflections that recognize the answers before I ask the questions. Hindsight's mirror, as if a loom, where the weaver's wisdom knows the way. I feel like I'm praying, by the way. Something we can count on, long enough, attention sways, and in that moment, where tall bridges signal they're open, maybe there, in relief, we can finally navigate atonement, see one another beyond projection, fixed frames, singular surfaces. Now read the letters, finally, just four letters, L-O-V-E.
Can I ask a question?
Oh, sure.
When you say what happens if we qualify evolution?
Yeah.
What if we qualify evolution?
Mm-hmm.
Can you clarify that beyond what followed in the poem? Or?
I really don't have a drawer for that right now.
Okay.
I only know what spilled out.
Yeah, okay. I was curious.
What was the question?
Interesting.
It's a good question. It's a great question.
What was the question?
What if we qualify evolution?
I was wondering what that meant.
I mean,
and her poem explained it a little bit.
Yeah. I could think that, you know, evolution probably has different meanings to different sects. and to me, it's more like personal evolution. We're all at a stage that we are, and we don't know how to do better yet until we go through the next portal.
That helps explain it.
Does that help?
Yeah.
Does anyone else want to say anything? Sam?
Just a comment on evolution. The cells in your body have to be able to predict what they're going to become when they split, when they do a subdivide. The DNA that's required to be there so that you end up a you. Has to be carried through in everything that's part of you, but it also comes with a sort of a menu of things it can foster in its becomingness, but it has to be predictive. It has to remember the future in order to become it. We don't like that question or that answer because science is supposed to be about the past. And the present, but the future is supposed to follow logically from that, but not spiritually. And that seems that the cells in your body know where they're going and what they're going to become before you do.
In a way, is that a comfort?
Well, it comforts me.
Thank you. This is a, does that help?
Yeah.
Thanks, Sam. I decided to put words over this painting that stems from Crescent Beach. And I'll just read you this one part because in the end, I think there's one word I left out that I wish was in here, sanctuary. And the other word is true north. So, this is a last minute. What thoughts arise along a wave when the brightest star lights up the night, when true north is your guide? This poem is called The Spill of a Pen, and I made the pastel illustrations in here, both black and white as a ballot grayscale. And color, so you could really see that difference. The spill of a pen. Is poetry meant to trip a silver tongue, tip a goblet slowly to pursed, polished lips, deep plunge into ancestry or accolade, or ride the rim of teenage love, to begin a journey, drive, or accompany in a sidecar? Fresh aspirations in new beginnings, or flesh worn dry in an old knit sweater, slumped down hard in mahogany rocking chair, resplendently carved antiques. Is poetry meant to gather a was, a memory, a moment, or what if, perhaps a possibility yet to come, which kind of refers to what Sam was saying. What if the writing serves to reel in the harvest, arriving then of its own accord, leaving little to ponder, prompt, pop, prod, or propose? As for perfection versus process, do we trace the day or listen for that still small voice, the quiet wisdom of I, or I and thou, or we? Do we walk through each doorway aware of its frame, or presumptive portals yet to be revealed, narrow or wide, open or fixed? Must one be just so, tighten buckle and belt, or free the birds from the bonnet while the wind blows off the hat? Okay, these two poems, the one on the left is more for courage and truth, and the one on the right, April's answer. A different story. The opened envelope. I don't want my poetry to boil down to one beige envelope. I want strong spices, cinnamon, paprika, lemon juice, cardamom, airplanes. Specific weather, high winds. If I have to work to feel to get beyond the calm of resolution, I don't want my senses delegated to the back of the room. I hope I don't make you too nervous. The shoe is on the other foot. Cover that giggle. Better to howl like a lion in the mirror of truth. Now this is April's answer. Lavender blue flowers blossom along hillsides. Not sure about the cornfields or relevance of crows. Rosemary fragrance after winter storms. Madronas gently arch toward wild foxglove. Harmony of blue skies. Spring greens lean forward, signaling with open hands. Effort or grace? Soul answers, fragrance, and flowers. This poem is the only one that I did in conjunction with a painting. And when that's done, it's called ekphrastic poetry. Mm-hmm. Like, I see this painting and I want to write a poem to it. It's called ekphrastic poetry. And I just did it in black and white as well to show the grayscale again. I'm just in love with the information and the visual of black and white, especially in conjunction to or relationship to seeing color. So here it is in color. So I'm looking at this going, okay, write a poem to it. Looking up, there are so many species of low, mid, and high-flying birds. Some swoop down into water from places higher than we generally look, especially during the day. Some may fall from the shoulders of angels, round edges of billowed or cumulus clouds, fair or heaped, producing showers, some brushed down by rain. Who's to say when we cannot always trust what we think we see? These flying ones enter definitely from the right side of the painting. Were they looking for new growth? Apples, insects, some kind of nectar, sweetness or blossom in new or declining stages? Perhaps some of these flying ones are literary in ways we cannot comprehend. Do we write the poem or does the bird drop the pen? And what of the feather momentary relationships pertaining to inkwells and glass bottles? What does the word inherent indicate anyhow? One thing I know, if I see more birds like this, I'll have more questions or more cause to wonder about wonder. Just now, looking more closely, I do notice they are hovering above the water, perhaps made partially of water like we are. Now they are entering from both above and below, and the burgundy colors may be an indicator of a recent communion with another form of nature. Perhaps a dip or a quick scoop into a pond full of blossoms or a vat of pomegranate or related fruit juices. Are those birds for sure wings, almost fin-like, definitely aiming for the tree, with harmonious sonar rhythm flying in unison? Not so much birds, more like flying fish. Definitely flying fish. Some fish gotta fly. You know what? I'm gonna break pattern. No surprise. This is a poem I wrote the other night at 5 in the morning, and I really liked it, so I thought I'd bring it. It's called 5 o'clock Pudding. I'll tell you why, and that's all I know. I was looking at the sky, and it was around 4-ish in the morning, and there were strange ripples in the sky that I don't usually see. I'm sure it was because of a weather pattern and no child threw chocolate pudding up there. The lines were like carved, like when chocolate pudding hardens and then changes in temperature. So that's why this became 5 o'clock pudding. It really isn't pudding. Unless you're thinking about chocolate pudding, when warm air meets cold, caked ripples carve a pattern, crested on top, resembling leaf shapes, lines that dig themselves into the surface. This evening's seam moments, palm to palm seam moments, previous day gliding into early morning, sky patterns vary, resembling water waves, almond eyes. I couldn't help but see how one thing resembles another. Patterns, lines, shapes, pudding sky, water waves. Words want to form a sentence to define themselves. Explain back to mind what my brain perceives, frequencies of loop and lineage. A kid on a bike rides by looking at everything on his immediate path, way different than Columbus discovering America. If he did or not is not the question. I don't really care. It's more about how we see, projecting our finite experience out through our eyeballs, naming things through language we've been taught, and framing things into squares. Nothing at all like a tree that we view and surmise through frames of horizontals and verticals, defining horizon line based on eye level, as though we are each the center of the universe. Imagine. We are like cameras running a projector with all senses, sounds, textures, and times we've lived, leaking out and permeating this universe. I, we, call me on sidewalks, perfumes of our lives. How to put all of that into a frame when there really is no container? Did you want that gift wrapped? Only you can choose the box. I'll have the one with no corners, please. No seams, no heartbreak or despair. No beginnings or ends. If there must be a container, make mine round. Give it a pulse and a heartbeat. Throw in some stars just for fun. I'm gonna read one more poem, and then I think it's a good duration, do you? We can see, but this is the last poem in the book. I like it because it has heart and some science. It's easier to get heart than science for me, but we're all different. Seafloor, molecules and memories. On the very bottom, slipped beneath a thin veil of silk, at the base of a thimble, floating for decades in sea kelp ruffled seas, lives a million memories, rising up in waves from everywhere. Hydrothermal vents, mud volcanoes, canyons, cold seeps, currents. Grandmother's embroidered flowers reminisce on slower winds. Rose petals, birch leaves, aspen and dogwood. Twirl and strum along the porch, an open gate, welcoming arms to shelter us home. And yes, hearts carry hearts, and love is never lost. Questions or concerns, joys and sorrows? Sharon?
How long did it take you to put this whole book together?
Well, the painting's a number of years. The writing, a few years, maybe a couple, this writing. And the book, I'd say just months, 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 and months. I love that the pages are thick.
Yeah.
I just, you know, especially as time moves on and the world is the way it is, I just hope this, like, not only has, here I go, blah, 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 you know, has connection for you, but gives more inspiration to, like, you know what, we're still alive, just keep doing it. I kind of feel like, I hate to say it, but if this thing keeps going that we're all having an experience with masks on and alcohol spray, I never sprayed my hands so much in my whole life, you know, I just might do another. Anyway.
Thank you, Susan. That was wonderful.
Yeah.
Another question?
Yeah. I just wondered if you liked putting the book together. Was it, you know, a creative process for you in the way that writing and drawing and making images?
It was a very different, you know, as you can imagine, it was a very different program.
Mm-hmm.
Carol has been doing this extensively herself. It was a very different program, and it exhausted me in a different way. You know, creative people, I can't speak for every creative or imaginative or curious person, but the energy is intense, and there's a burnout. And this was a different burnout. I was way more agitated. I was way more, where's my keys? Did I put my dog in the refrigerator, God forbid?
Gotcha. That's why I asked.
Yeah, a different kind of exhaustion, different kind of, like, I can't handle one thing. Yeah.
I just want to say, it was very educational for me to be with you during the process of this book evolving and just really appreciating all the details and thoughts that go into everything, including how does the book lay flat? What age of paper and what goes with what and what size and what shape, and it was really impressive to watch them go.
And so much to learn, right? Thank you.
And did you do that all on your own?
You will never get away from me. You can climb the tallest tree. I'll be there somehow, I said to myself. Because I tried to work with other people. I tried it. I can't. True confessions. But really, you know, I tried with two other people. One, a man on Camino Island who has helped, you know, publish books before. But there was a technology interface that was just totally escaping me. And he said, okay, turn this file into a and I can't find the one you sent. So that didn't work after 3 months. And then I looked at all different, you know, programs online. And then I started working with someone else who very kindly said, yeah, I'll just hold the files for you, the poems. Let's just start with 10. And now which 10 paintings do you want to go with the poem? And that was like, whose house is that? I don't know how to think about that now. And so your answer is, yeah, I did it. And I'm so glad I did it, the whole thing by myself. Because then it puts one, Deborah's an artist too, and working on things like this, it puts one so much more into the whole process. Like, I really felt like when I was done, boom. You know, rather than, how come that piece of me is over there on page 42? That's not turquoise, you know? I mean, whatever. Yeah, so it was really fulfilling. You know, and then we address, oh God, I do want to read some more, but I don't want to make it too long. Do you want one more poem?
Yeah.
This one's pretty. Okay, I'll read this one.
Yeah.
So if you can do it on your own, I so recommend it. So worth it. I'm having more water.
Water's good for you.
It's so good for you. Water, madrona trees, honoring the spirits that have been here before. Sometimes annoying. How many of us carried a huge stack of books, scurrying out old library doors as children, wings of anticipation? I can't wait to see the pictures and read the stories, glean their meaning way down to my soul bones. Maybe one day I'll write one too. My grandmother said on a quiet mound, it's great to haven't cried yet, this is fantastic. My grandmother said on a quiet mound of earth in a Connecticut field, a graveyard, gray stones and flowers, stick with one thing. Her message, a focus, goal, objective, embodying essence, wisdom, purpose, beyond this moment, yet in this moment, complying, not denying gravity or direction. As formations occur, when does a line become wide enough to affect context? Is it weight we consider, or mass, relativity, or scale? Can the colors of the abalone shell be reduced to one hue or compared in any way to a grain of sand? Is focus really a verb? Does it have wings, fly, or nest? Does grammar really care if it had to do over? And what of the sun rising or gradual setting? If one follows the twirling buzz of the APIS or honeybee, I had to Google it. Then what? Headache or honey? What signifies a noun, that which sits solid in a chair? For how long do we perceive energy as matter? If the sensory could be converted to math, color to music, memory to shape, and line to form, intuition to prescription, and prescription to volition, well then maybe one could maintain a constant. As weather informs us, barometrics, biospheres, patterns, and atmospheres, changing courses and coastlines, wrinkling the clothing, splashing salmon off of west wind tumbling seas, how can we predict? What do we mean by cohesion? Paths firmly planted in masses of stone, zircon perhaps, seemingly solid with no particles of visible air, no turns, no pivots whatsoever. Bring the broader moment where the seed of everything arises from one thing, when the timeless becomes the palpable, essence becomes form, atom becomes an apple, one apple, a round red apple.
Book you've produced. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
Yeah. And just a few more things. Sorry. One is, would all of you, so there's two questions I ask at the end of every program. One is, would you recommend this program to a friend?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And then secondly, did you have a question?
No.
Oh, sorry. Is there anyone here who learned about the event aside from Susan?
Saw the signs, and I mean, I knew that, but
yeah.
I definitely noted the signs.
The big signs. The
yeah. Well, wasn't there?
The
there was one by the up on the corner.
Yeah. Great.
The
I think the chamber glass.
Yeah.
Chamber glass. Lovely.
Yeah.
And I appreciated the sign in front of the library too, mm-hmm. and on Facebook.
charge of it, and that'll get better.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see, third thing. Oh, if anyone's concerned about photos of you going out into the internet, none of the recordings will include you. If there are photos taken today and that you're concerned, just let me know. Fourth,
my name on it.
Pardon me?
Don't put my name on it.
We're exploring another experiment. We're doing a few experiments with events. A lunchtime story time for adults.
Mm.
Maybe poetry, maybe storytelling, maybe just reading. Would that be of interest if we could do it out here? Is that sort of a no? Nah. Yeah.
It's just
bad
time.
Yeah.
You know, maybe it's just not me.
Oh,
yeah,
it's not
yeah,
that
yeah.
time.
So maybe well, maybe
would
half
you
and
be
half.
Eating and talking or talking and eating?
Bring
and
your
eating?
Lunch.
Or
you would bring your lunch, and then we would have someone who would be talking.
Sounds good to me.
There's a library program I heard on, I read about on Facebook, and it's called the Human Library.
Right.
And you bring people and sit them down. They have a sign that says, you know, Buddhist monk, PSD survivor, and so you check out a person.
That's really interesting. I like that.
It's scary.
That's a great idea.
I mean,
and I want to clarify that if it was on a weekend, that might
weekend.
Yeah.
Weekend lunchtime. Yeah, maybe like midday on a Sunday. Great. And does anybody get information about events through the Senior Signal? The Senior Center's newsletter? No. Okay. And lastly, big, huge thank you to all of you for coming and for you, Susan,
thank
for all
you.
The effort you put into.